At the India Today Conclave South, we've had an opportunity so far to listen to some of the state's most influential politicians. We've had an opportunity to listen to national ministers, leaders of parties. Over the next half an hour, we want to listen to one of the most important businessmen of the state of Tamil Nadu and of South India in general. To talk about what is it that Tamil Nadu needs from a governance, administration, and industry perspective. Our next guest at the India Today South Conclave is not just one of the heavyweight corporate tycoons of South India, but also one of the most influential personalities in the country. One time he ran world cricket, ran Indian cricket. That was taken away from him in unceremonious circumstances, only to find later that not much really changed. So can you please join me in welcoming to the India Today Conclave, Mr. N. Srinivasan. India Cements is incidentally celebrating its 75th year. So it's a very special year for the India Cements family and for Mr. Srinivasan personally. And we're delighted to have you here with us at the Conclave.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us and thank you for breaking your silence after so long. We're in the middle of a hectic election campaign, Mr. Srinivasan. Tamil Nadu, for a long time, was one of the top industrialized states in the country. Now other states are catching up. And in that context, if I were to ask you, what do you think Tamil Nadu needs over the next 5 years to stay at the forefront of India's industrial and growth story? What would be your vision to Tamil Nadu's politicians?
Actually, if you look at Tamil Nadu, we have every kind of industry. Modern information technology with all the ramifications, all the attendant companies. We have a very healthy traditional engineering base. We have raw material oriented industries. We have sugar, paper, we have cement, we have got automobile. I think you can name the industry Tamil Nadu has it. Now, it is growing. If you look at Tamil Nadu, the production in this state, it is growing. What is the reason for it? Why do people come here? Why do people invest in Tamil Nadu? Because the industrial climate in Tamil Nadu, the industrial culture here is outstanding. We as a company have got investments. We manufacture in many states in India. But by and large, I would say Tamil Nadu is very good. The given a chance, I will invest here. I happen to be in a business which is raw material oriented, limestone. So, and since almost 35% of India's limestone is in the four southern states, which will become a cement hub. But we recognize every other. There is a paper industry, there is a textile industry, there is sugar industry, there is engineering industry, there is automobile industry. Everybody has come. Why have everyone gravitated here? Because over the years, changing government does not mean changing policy. We've had different governments here, but all of them have done something for Tamil Nadu. They have not forgotten Tamil Nadu.
But take, for example, automobile manufacturing and ancillaries, which at one point in time, Tamil Nadu led the country. Now other states are catching up, and some would argue even overtaking Tamil Nadu. So why is it that the advantage the state had for a while is now being frittered away, and what can be done to regain that advantage?
See, I won't say it is being frittered away, because people invest because they find that they will get a return out of that investment. In the old days and even now, a lot of people invest because of the various tax breaks that you get, because of sales tax breaks that you get. So this is also a factor that is very important to an investor. So there is competition between states. as to who will give a better package to the investor. So therefore, I would not look at it. I would look at it that Tamil Nadu has a very diversified portfolio of manufacture, which I don't think any other state has.
In the political context, between the two visions that are being offered, on the one side you've got the ruling AIADMK along with the BJP, on the other side you've got the DMK, the Congress seeking to challenge the status quo. How do you see people evaluating the decision about who will be able to govern Tamil Nadu better over the next 5 years?
I think it is a difficult question to answer because I can talk about industry. I can talk about the industrial culture. It has not changed whether the Jayalalitha was the chief minister or Karunanidhi was the chief minister. They both cared for Tamil Nadu, and industrialization took place, and it was quite rapid. The political conflict between the two parties did not enter the industrial field. See, therefore, in a sense, the industry was left alone to grow. So therefore, if you ask me, it is difficult to say who would, I mean, all I can say, the present government has done a very good job. I mean, nobody expected that the present government of Edappadi, Chief Minister Edappadi Palaniswamy would do such a good job as they have done. So this is in keeping with what has happened. We have seen before, administration is good. Always Tamil Nadu is renowned for its bureaucracy, good advice, good labor culture. So I think I'm, in a sense, it doesn't matter who wins, Tamil Nadu will win.
Interesting. We've spoken a bit about what's happening in the industrial complex in Tamil Nadu. I want to shift attention to what you think is happening with the Indian economy and the Modi government's policy interventions. It now seems, after 6 years of dithering, the government's finally taken an outrightly rightward turn when it comes to its philosophy on economics. And there is now talk of privatization, disinvestment, corporates playing a bigger role. How do you see the latest policy pronouncements of the central government, Mr. Srinivas?
I think this budget was an excellent budget. I am on record on this. For the first time, the government has said, I'm not bothered about fiscal deficit. I'm bothered about India. I want India to grow. So instead of having a policy where I only look at what money comes in, I'm going to spend money. I'm going to spend money which I have. I'm going to spend money by disinvestment. And therefore, the emphasis is on infrastructure. The emphasis is on growth, definitely on growth. And I think that's very good. I think it is one of those, I mean, for the first time, I've been listening to budget for several decades. But this, I think, was the best. And here, government has signaling that I am going to make a turn. I'm going to make a right turn. And this is going to help the country. And I think that's very decisive.
So while that's the government's stated intention, one of the key ingredients of success is whether private industry and companies such as yours are willing to increase private investment and pump money into the India story. We've seen over the past few years, private industry pulling back and not wanting to invest because of excess capacity, not just for your company and your sector. How do you view this question in a national context?
See, one has to realize, for the first time, a direction has been given. The government has said, this is where I will turn right and I will proceed on that road. This will attract investment, I think. I think this will give the sufficient confidence for people to invest in this country. And we are a very large manufacturing country. Not only that, we are a large consuming country. See, a lot of what we produce, we consume. See, many countries, their problem is they produce, they have to export. But here, we export a lot, but we can consume a lot. And I think that makes a big difference.
We've spent some time talking about industry. I want to now focus on your other love, which is cricket. And I want to take the bull by the horns. It often strikes me, what do you think of the current state of Indian cricket? Because you ran world cricket at the ICC, you ran the BCCI, then that was taken away from you, charges were leveled, you had to step aside. New managements came in, then the Supreme Court got involved, judges came in trying to run the sport. Many people who view cricket from the outside wonder whether anything changed at all. Do you think Indian cricket is better run today than it was under you?
See, I always maintain our cricket is as good as our players. I think the emphasis that we have placed on giving opportunities for people across India, not just in Bombay and Delhi, but across India, to showcase their wares, has paid off. You see, what did we do? We recognized all old cricketers, we had a pension scheme. We also encouraged cricketers from all states. How did an MS Dhoni come? So, Indian cricket is, you see, I distinguish, see, one is cricket administration. The other is Indian cricket. Indian cricket is good. For the first time, we won a series in Australia. Our people did a wonderful rear guard action and then won the series. And we are continuing to play well now. Every time somebody is putting up his hand up to say, I'm here, I will save the country, I will win the match for you. So I think, if you look at Indian cricket, there is so much talent around. And I think I attribute a lot of this to the IPL also. You see, IPL has made Indian cricketers play with all the best foreign cricketers, and they have developed a lot of confidence. You see, self-confidence is very important in a game like cricket. And you can see that, you know, you can see that the way India played in Australia, the way India played in India, in England, against England.
Do you think Supreme Court judges can run Indian cricket?
See, I generally do not comment, I cannot comment about judges, Supreme Court, etc. All I can say is that cricket, there was nothing greatly wrong with the Indian cricket administration. And also, for example, charges were leveled. But nothing, there was nothing leveled against me, nothing against me at all. I asked Arnab Goswami once, and I mentioned this to you, and I don't mind repeating it. But I was on the front page of the Times of India for 13 days. Even Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi never got this privilege. Even when India got independent, Jawaharlal Nehru did not get it. What did I do for this? Nothing. It was just, there was a prejudice. People wanted to sandbag me. Okay, but nothing has happened over a period of time. People have understood the truth. I am more respected today. I get respect in the BCCI. I get respect outside. We did a lot for Indian cricket. You see, most of the money for international cricket comes out of India. Almost 80% comes out of India. India was getting 2%. What did I do? I did not say I want 80%. I said we at least get 20%. This money can be used to develop infrastructure in India, to improve the quality of the stadia where we play. But one of my successors who went, he gave this money back because he wanted only to elect himself. So therefore he acted, you know, but we will get it, you know, ultimately the money has to come. See, we must realize that almost all 80% of the money that goes into international cricket comes out of India. But you cannot have any country ignore India. But you can't take India's money and spend it elsewhere completely. I mean, spend it on, you know, India needs it also.
You know, you said ultimately we'll get it back. I'm wondering who will get it back. Do you see yourself now as a retired cricket administrator, Mr. Srinivasan, or do you still somewhere at the back of your heart harbor hopes of coming back and padding up again at BCCI?
No, I what I meant was, I'm so passionate about it, I said I'll get it back. I think you will see that India will get its money, due share back.
If this was cricket, I bowled you an outswinger and you let it go. Can I engage you once again and get you to play a shot? And I'll ask you the question directly. Does Mr. Srinivasan harbor hopes of coming back to run Indian cricket?
You see, I have had a very good innings. And there are good people now who are running Indian cricket. So I think it is very difficult to answer this question. But all I can say is that when looking at Indian cricket, you must look at the Indian cricketer. He is the one who produces the money for India. It is his game. Because Indian people love the game that they play, which is why they put the money there. So difficult to answer your question, because the answer is I don't know.
If I were to understand what you're saying, you're basically saying you're open to the idea. If the pitch is conducive, you don't mind going out for another knock.
It's difficult. You know, under today's circumstances, it's difficult to give you a straight answer. I'm being honest.
I know. So it's a bouncer. You're ducking the bouncer and acknowledging, yes, that's a dangerous ball. I just left it and that's fine. You run one of the most successful IPL franchises, not just in terms of how they play, but even commercially, in terms of the money they make, in terms of brand recall. What is your secret sauce? What is the magic formula that makes Chennai Super Kings, not just the heartthrobs of the people of Chennai, but such a hit and a sensation across the country?
There are two, three points. You see, first is that you must recognize that Chennai was one of the five original test centers in India where test cricket was played. So when IPL was launched, I said, Chennai must have a team. So India Cement wrote to the then president, Sharad Pawar sir, and asked, can we bid? I have been writing a letter saying that although I was a treasurer, India Cement could bid. This has been forgotten in all the statements made subsequently. India Cement did not bid without permission. Asked for, yes, you can bid. So we bid. Why? Because Chennai is such a cricket-loving city. Cricket, you know, it should have a franchise. And this is what happened. Then MS Dhoni came. He fell in love with Chennai. Chennai fell in love with him. Rest is history. But there is one very important factor. When you look at franchise-based cricket, franchise, you know, this is not new in all countries. It has been there for decades before. You own the franchise, not the player. So therefore, you have to treat the player is an individual who contributes to the franchise. I think we recognize the fact that we own the franchise, not the player. Players were very happy to play for us, and the public took to CSK, the whole world took to CSK, because word of mouth, a lot of cricketers, international cricketers, see, the world is small in one sense. Word goes on, okay, this is the franchise to play for. That is how the legend grew.
But MS Dhoni is currently in Chennai. You said he's in a bio bubble preparing for the IPL. The world has moved on. You've now got the likes of Rishabh Pant who are setting the international stage on fire. And for some reason, you and Chennai Super King still persist with somebody who many would think is now a player from the past.
Well, that's debatable. See, for your information, MS Dhoni is in Chennai. He takes his cricket so seriously, he's practicing in the morning in the indoor nets, and the afternoon he's practicing at Chepauk. He's a very determined person, and that is what we like. You know. And one more thing, while talking about this, that cricket is about winning, IPL is about winning. But there is also such a thing as consistency and loyalty. And I think that is what oozes out of us. We are in cricket for the last 50 years. We started in the early 60s. By the time the 60s were closing to an end, almost the entire Indian Tamil Nadu Ranji Trophy team was employed by us. So we have been in cricket for a long time. We've been running teams. We have a true appreciation and a good appreciation of good cricket.
And finally, if you were to look back at the period when you said you were more in the news than Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, what do you think is the lesson you learned? What do you think is the mistake you made? What is it that you would have liked to do differently?
See, I can't do anything differently because we did not do anything wrong. But at the same time, I think the success of the Chennai Super King was one of the reasons why people went after us. Hindsight is 20/20, but I don't know. If I have done something wrong, I will change it. Not having done something wrong, it's a game. People must recognize that cricket is a game. We played sincerely, we played seriously.
Well, you indeed have played very seriously. You've come on the red pitch at the India Today conclave, as it were. You've batted with style. You've left a few outswinging balls. You've ducked a few bouncers, but you've stood your ground. And you've broken your silence after a very long while. This is, as I said, a very special year for you. So we wish you all the very best. And from what I understood, you've said, I am neither tired nor retired. And my understanding is, if you get a chance, you will give another shot at trying to manage the BCCI.
Thank you very much for your time. Thank you for inviting me. And I want to say one thing. That is, when I was young, the only magazine I read, at least, was India Today.
That's very nice of you to say so. The India Today magazine is still growing strong. And I hope you're also watching our TV channel, our website, our YouTube, and continuing the association with the brand. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us here at the India Today Conclave.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.